So today's topic is distortion. And let me say a couple things about it first, and then we can dialogue a little more about aspects of distortion that you'd like to look into and that we can explore. because as we'll find with all of these topics, everybody has their own interpretation of what the topic is. So when I say, when Ra says that's a distortion, or like Ra talking about the law of free will, the first distortion of the law of one is the law of free will. So cosmic law as distortion. So that's pretty high up in the chain of creation that one of the fundamental laws by which the Logos has established the cosmic plan of soul evolution, meaning the structure of octaves and dimensions, galaxies and stars and planets and densities, the structure in which soul evolution or beings evolving energy consciousness or light love, in which that whole thing is occurring, guided by law of free will, meaning do what thou wilt. It's not the whole of the law, as Crowley said. It's the first law, but there's the truth of the lawgiver, or the source of the law, which is critical on the path, which of course he doesn't understand. But if even the law of free will, a guiding principle of the structure and function of creation, is a distortion, then it's a major aspect of all creational life, distortion. Now, if we go into, let me just read some definitions and etymology and start with that. There are two parts to the word distortion. There's dis and torsion, obviously. Dis, as a prefix, sometimes means not, Wikipedia. It's actually not, it's Wiktionary. Wiktionary gives a three different definitions for the prefix dis, D-I-S. One is to break apart, like disorder. Another is a reversal, like dissimulation. I'll send the link here. This is actually very interesting. So the second meaning of the prefix dis is reversal, removal. And the third is utterly or exceedingly or completely. Like, they're using Latin here, but stuffed full, defertus, differed, F and S have a relation. Anyway, we're not going to get stuck in etymology. So distortion is the third usage of the prefix dis, which means completely. And so the common etymological basis of distortion is distorcere, completely twisted. And so torsion is like torque. And if we apply it in a strange, you know, in a blanket sense to the reality, the metaphysical reality that all of creation is a distortion. Yet, because I mean, even the essential creational law of free will is a distortion. It's a distortion of the law of one, meaning it is a complete twisting or turning or spinning. The word torcere, or the suffix, you know, distortion, distorcere, means completely or utterly twisted or turned or bent or spun or wound. This complete, let's just say, complete twisting is of creation. And so, yet, is it of creation, or is it of the consciousness that perceives? And so, we looked at the basis of the questions, and it was written, given that we're born into so many distortions, or we're surrounded by distortions, we encounter daily distortions since birth, or we're born into so many distortions, or everything is a distortion until we evolve beyond seventh density. All of that is relatively true. However, is the distortion the nature of creation or love light? Or is the distortion the interpretation or the being, the perception that says distortion? And so when we're looking at distortion, there's some very profound philosophical considerations. If the basis of creation is the three laws, the law of free will, the law of love, the law of light, or light, intelligent energy, third law, came out of the interplay of the first two laws, although they're numbered, and we can say sequentially ordered, right? The law of free will interacting with the law of love, producing the law of light, or the origin of light being the action of free will upon love, said Ra. So we can say that there are three. We can say that those three have an apparently linear process of relation. The law of free will, the law of love, or the action of free will upon love generates light. Okay. That's apparently sequential of an apparent triad, yet it's all one. Now, to say that it's three is relative view or relative truth. To say that the three is one is also relative view, because actually absolute view is unutterable, or distortion is actually any conceptualization. So Ra talks about look around you, see the creator. Well, how can, and that a quality of contact with intelligent infinity experience is unspeakable joy. Yes, that's true. And so, contact with intelligent infinity, or activation of seventh chakra, leads to an experience of unspeakable joy. And it also leads to, or associated with, a sense of the all consecrate, the all hallowed. Meaning, I look at the wall in my bathroom, I see the creator. That's God in the form of a brick wall. I look at, the railing on the stairs, and I see the creator. That's a practice. It's not a fantasy. It's a practice training awareness to realize that all is the one infinite creator, and that's called the law of one. Okay? Now, is it then that I'm surrounded by distortions and everything is a distortion until we evolve beyond seventh density? Or we perceive distortion, or our perception leads to distorted interpretation, or perception as a whole, as itself, is distortion, right? Even consciousness is born of ignorance, said Gautama. So then we get into the five skandhas, and the five constituents of the apparent self that could be saying everything's a distortion, or we're encountering daily distortions since birth. Well, that is relatively true. You know, if you talk to people, and they have certain views of this and that, they're kind of distorted. They're not too broad or deep. And even us, even these views are distorted and limited. However, when Ra says, all is love light, all is the creator, this is not something that happens in seventh density. It's a reality that may be perceived by higher self and seventh density being, but we can perceive it now. But what about perception itself? So in Buddhism, these five constituents of a self, the five skandhas, form, feeling, form or body, which includes energy fields like an astral body, is form. Second is sensation or feelings, or basically stimulation or disturbance or activity of that form. So form, feelings, or sensation. Then perception, which is a kind of bridging of mind-body in which there are six senses, spheres of sense, touch, taste, smell, sight, hearing, and the mind sense. And so perception, quote, as a constituent of the self or sense of self, the apparent self, is a concept we use to express the activity of the different sense doors, touch, taste, smell, sight, hearing, and thought, that lead us to conceptualize a material world in which we have a body which is distinct from other bodies, in which we experience thought or interpretation, which brings us to the fourth skanda, which is samskara, which is the most important of all, I think, which is fashionings or fabrications, volitional compounds, or basically composite thought, what we normally call thought and feeling, right? Emotions and thought. And that's really where the sense of self is made. The sense of self is ahamkara, is aham is kara, karma, aham karma. It actually means self, karmic creation, the karmic creation of a sense of self. Now, that's where distortion comes in. And then the fifth skanda is consciousness. But Gautama said even consciousness, so all of the five skandas, these five constituents of a sense of self, came out of ignorance, or not knowing, or avidya, or occur to beings in the octave, except for beings who come from out of the octave into the octave and retain full ability to master their experience through eight dimensions. They're eight-dimensionally aware in real time. They would be without avidya, I assume. Like Gautama and Nityananda. Now, so at one level we can say that the very reality of apparent beings with apparently separative bodies and consciousness or personality arising in what appears to be a seven-dimensional octave, or the octaves, galaxies, stars, planets, that's what we see by our sight perception, visual perception, and the mind sense that conceives it. Actually, that's really all. We can say we smell and we taste, but mainly we're seeing galaxies and stars and planets. And we're hearing other beings talking, and they talk differently than us, so we obviously can assume that they're not me, right? Only a psychotic will say you're me. But Ra says you are everything. And so distortion is in the mind of the beholder. Meanwhile, the entirety of birth and death, the realm of samsara, birth and death, meaning the octaves, the seven-dimensional, at least this seven-dimensional octave, is guided by the primary first principle law of free will, which is the first distortion of the law of one. And so the very basis of creation is distortion, or the law of free will, the action of free will upon love, giving rise to light, love, light, intelligent energy, seven-dimensional, you know, white light, or the, you know, light with a capital L, giving rise to the seven frequencies of dimension, the seven rays came out of intelligent energy. So that light is not, you know, the light coming from the sun. It's energy, pure power energy, that is the result of infinite free will on infinite love, action of free will upon love. But that whole process is a distortion, according to Ra, and is some kind of completely twisted situation, completely bent. You know, hey man, you're bent. Hey man, creation is totally bent. In some sense, And that's why Gautama said, even consciousness is born of ignorance. And Ra said, when they go to seventh density, they have no more memory, no more identity. And so any relative perception of self and other, meaning identity, that's the self and other, the perception or interpretation, perception of, and then samskaric conceptualization of, or some kind of perception, let's say visual or thought or auditory, whatever, some kind of perception precedes some kind of interpretation fashioning that there's a me, and that includes some kind of the interpretation that there's a me and a you. There's a me, there's a you, because I'm visually perceiving particularly my body or this body here and that body there, and then listening to your talk and my talk, which are quite different, and you have your way, I have my way, so obviously we're not one. That's called relative view. Now, while that notion is a distortion, we know all is one, but we also experience a lot of duality all the time. Both are true, and yet both are also distortion. You see, when Ra says, this is from the early, this is actually, I looked at the Law of One results in the Law of One .info site. So Law of One .info site, Law of One category, Law of One. Here in the first session, 1.7, Ra said the famous line, "You are everything, every being, every emotion, every event, every situation. You are unity, you are infinity. You are love, light, light, love. You are, this is the Law of One." So that is the total identity of all there is as one. And that one as infinity. And so there's perception and interpretation of, perception, conception, or at least conception of duality, me and you, time and space. Then there is perception, some kind of perception, and then conception, which is an experience, right? We're experiencing our conceptions. We're experiencing our interpretations. To say that, I and the floorboard are two, is my experience of my interpretation of my perception, visually, kinesthetically. I feel my body here and that thing over there. I see my body here, or I see a body here, and I see a floor there, and I, which is another supposition, differentiate that I am over here and that thing over there is not me. That's experience of duality coming from perception. Likewise, the experience of all is one also comes from, is a conceptual experience. It's a concept-oriented experience based on some kind of perception, like, fifth and sixth and seventh jhanas in meditation, right? Infinity of space, infinity of consciousness, nothingness. So we are very much experiencing the interpretations of our perceptions. And that whole thing arises out of avidya, the whole five skanda set of how it is we fashion an identity. To say you are infinity is about as far as you can go in words, because infinity negates a distinct you. And that's why Ra said in seventh density they have no identity. And so this completely twisted situation, or completely twisted nature of creation, begins with the sequence by which creation comes to be, the law of free will. So that distortion, which is arose in the mind of the infinite as the concept of finity, and the illusion of light, or the concept of light, you see, you can say that everything's a distortion. You can also say that the true nature of all this that appears to be distortion is Godhead infinity. Both. So it's not quite true that we're born into distortions. It's not quite true that everything is a distortion until we evolve beyond seventh density. The very nature of creation arose out of concept, which is considered illusory. So Ra talked about the infinite creator discerning a concept, which is finity, and then generating light, which is the concept of light, and generating time and space or dimensionalities that are called the illusion of limits. Meanwhile, you are dancing thoughts, meaning vibratory concepts in the mind of infinity. Now, even that kind of strange metaphysical view is a distortion. And so, unity is a distortion to the prior distortion of experiencing duality. Yet, you can say we experience duality, then by higher development we may experience unity and realize that duality is an illusion. Okay. Then, by higher development, we realize that that unity is an infinity, and then realize that unity and duality themselves is a polarity, represent a polarity that falls away in, you know, when we leave the octave. But the awareness and knowing beyond distortion that is natural to, you know, 7th and 8th density. 7th and 8th, I think, are not so different. But the knowing, that knowing of infinity, infinite being, in 7th and 8th density, and relatively free from distortion, let's say. Because, you know, Ra said, the crystallized healer has no will. That's an adept. But beyond the adept is Atman in 7th density and 8th. And particularly 7th and 8th density beings, are beyond free will, because they're, you know, in the lap of the infinite. They're in the fusion with infinity process, in 7 going to 8, and then they become infinity, or become the Logos in 8. From the awareness that they have, natural in those dimensions, 7, 8, is an awareness of reality that we can develop here, at least somewhat, but it's an awareness of a reality that is as real here while we're embodied in 3D space-time as it is real and known for them in those higher dimensions. So, any discussion of the word distortion has to start with that, you know, ontological, cosmological perspective, metaphysical ontology, cosmology, meaning multidimensional, the physical, non-physical, physical, metaphysical blend of the nature of being and the nature of cosmos, or how creation came to be from the from infinity or the infinite creator, discerning that concept of finity, and then eventually by distortion upon distortion. All three laws are distortion: law of free will, law of love, law of light. So even to say infinite will, infinite love, infinite light, presence, is a differentiation of infinity. These are attributes of infinity, which are basically differentiations that could be called distortions. But while then you can say everything's a distortion, you can also say that nothing's a distortion. Because the reality that is known in 7th and 8th density is the same reality we're living in now. It's just that we don't see it. And they, in 7th and 8th density, live there seeing that, native to those, it's native at that level, at those levels. But what they see and know is the same reality that we're experiencing now, or we may experience now, or is the basis for our limited experiencing now, available to be more fully experienced now. So that's the big context view of distortion. Where would you like to go now? Well, yeah, you raised many questions. Number one, yes, of course, some individuals take advantage of the fact that here in third density, with veil in mind, distortion is sort of the natural, is a continual product of mental process. And so opinion is distortion, even, because any conceptualization, by its very nature, is distortion, even though there are some conceptualizations that are more or less distorted, or some are more distorted than others, like I am a pink penguin is more distorted than saying I am Scott talking to you now. So some people take advantage of it, yes. Now, your real question may be, I just want to say before that, in Buddhist theory, or in the history of Buddhism, I think I'm not sure if it's Chinese or Japanese Zen, Chinese Chan, Japanese Zen, there is a way of describing enlightenment as awakening within the dream, no longer dreaming within the dream, becoming awake within the dream. The dream is the dream of samsara. The dream is of the octave. The octave is a dream in the mind of infinity. And that's why Ra said you're dancing thoughts, vibrating conceptualities, or vibrating samskaric fashionings of identity and experience, right? Our identity is fashioned by mind. Notions of path are fashioned, and the experience of a dimensionality is also fashioned by mind. That's why the seventh jhana is perception of nothingness. Actually, there's a big lizard coming to say hello right outside my window now. About a 7-inch, 10-inch guy. Very long tail, these guys. I think they kind of bob up and down like they're doing some kind of prayer. So maybe he's enjoying the energetics. But the entirety of the five skanda system, including particularly fashioned conceptualization, which is what we're experiencing, is of the nature of a dream. The octave coming out of the first three distortions, the octaves, meaning galaxies, intelligent energy or light, the big boom, the big bang, is the product of distortion. So the basis of creation is distortion. The basis of identity and a notion of path and development is, which includes memory, is a distortion. Then there are some distortions that are less helpful than others, like I'm a pink penguin versus I'm a being of mind-body-spirit complex. One opinion is a little bit more likely or helpful to evolve than the other. Yes, people take advantage and distort each other and make more distortion, yet the true nature of this creational distortion, which is the dream, its true nature is infinity. Now, that reality may be seen by the awakened, who awaken within the dream, but they know they're in a dream. Time and space is a dream. Seven-dimensional octaves is a dream. And that's what Ra calls the concept of light. And that's the dream nature is what Ra calls the illusion of limits. These are really profound terms that, to me, they're very profound, in my distorted opinion, because they fit perfectly with a Buddhist-Hindu understanding of Maya and Avidya. Maya meaning illusion, Hinduism, and Avidya being ignorance, Buddhism. as the root basis of an experience of ourselves as a being on a path, and the basis of suffering and some work to do. So the illusion of limits is ultimately the one way of describing the octaves, which is the structure, the evolutionary structure that comes out of galaxies and planets and stars, or stars and planets and worlds with physical conditions. All of that is of intelligent energy. Seven rays come out of intelligent energy. All of that is a concept of finity, or a manifestation of a concept of finity, a concept of light. So the concept of finity gave birth to the concept of light, gave birth to the realm of the illusion of limits, which is the dream. And awakening within the dream, first is the awakening that it is a dream. Secondly is to get some sense that the true nature of the dream is infinite clear light. Dzogchen. The nature of the dream is indescribable, blissful, infinite reality that, you know, is ultimately indescribable. And that's, you know, intelligent infinity. So intelligent infinity as the nature, as the true nature of the illusion of limits, provided or, you know, established by a concept of light, intelligent energy, coming out of the realization of the concept of finity, or of the infinite, to discern the concept finity. And so, then down here on the ground, as you wrote, we are born into a culture where there are all sorts of mistaken assumptions, wrong assumptions about what is, in terms of self, in terms of society, in terms of values, right? I mean, why is there even a discussion of moral values? It's because it's not obvious unless it's presented. Unless people talk about what morality is, like sila, panchashila, or the Ten Commandments, or yama niyama, Buddhism, in Hinduism, right? What to do, what not to do. Unless there's some discussion of that, you know, human mind coming out of the animal kingdom doesn't know much about what to do, or what is to my long-term welfare and benefit. And so, how to navigate through the, you know, the distortions which infect your peoples, as Ra said, is discernment, of course. And then how to develop discernment? Well, that's a whole other discussion. That's not for today. But discernment is basically the result, Gautama said, of consistently asking the wise and the worthy, what conduces to my long-term welfare and benefit, and what does not? What's good for me? What's not good for me? What's better? What's worse? What are consequences? And that's where we get into morality, and then eventually, you know, morality, meditation, and then leading to insight, right? Sila, samadhi, prajna. So that's what conduces to our long-term welfare and benefit. Is harmlessness as you know, the basis of morality, any morality, religious or not, as the basis of developing the mind for meditation and concentration, samadhi, and the ability to know things pretty clearly, or at least come to some, to discern a relatively less distorted perspective, and then by consistent practice, meditation, samadhi, getting insight into the supramundane wisdom, the nature of self, or, you know, experiencing the union of form and emptiness, or the union of finity, infinity, seeing the creator everywhere, or knowing everything is a creator, or realizing in real time now and living the infinity true nature of all that appears in the illusion of limits. And so, and then of course from that we can more easily discern mistaken beliefs or more distorted beliefs from less distorted beliefs. And as to, you wrote here, what's acceptable distortions, unacceptable distortions, that's a personal thing, right? Some people feel, you know, coloring their hair red is conduces to my long-term welfare and benefit. Okay, well, fine, go right ahead. I mean, I wear this clothes and not that clothes, so that's my own, you know, petty opinion about what is comfortable to wear. One can know oneself more fully, obviously, with discernment. And also know the less distorted, or pull out the less distorted truth from the welter or tangle of complex cultural assumptions. He's come all the way to my window. He's gone from the railing, and he jumped over right to my window, and now he's walking about 3 feet away from me by the window, just to say hello. The same big lizard. How about that? Maybe he wants to hear the Dharma. Hopefully I can share. Discernment obviously is critical, but in the end we're going from less helpful distortion to more helpful distortion to less distortion and less veiling, and in fact the veil can be removed in third density. I mean, that's called fourth stage awakening, and we're not going to get that in this incarnation generally, but we can approach. And ultimately, if you want to know how to develop discernment, another way is understand more deeply the nature of fourth, fifth, sixth chakra activation. Discernment is developed, or is a natural product of increased fourth, fifth, sixth chakra activation. And so discernment is the fruit of fifth ray, fifth chakra development, while love or compassion or care, warm-heartedness, care, natural caring, is a natural product more associated with fourth ray. And love, or the capacity to unconditionally accept what is, regardless of how we feel or regardless of what it is fourth ray. And that's, of course, very much the basis of fifth ray, which is a less distorted conceptualization of life or reality or phenomena or situations that is more helpful than simply knowledge. Right? There's knowledge and wisdom, and discernment is the basis of knowing the difference between knowledge and wisdom. Knowledge is transient, and wisdom is ultimately less transient, or more associated with path and transformation of being. And so then acceptable, unacceptable is a personal matter, but as discernment grows, people are more aware of what's a less distorted set of values and what is a more distorted set of values. And in many ways you can evaluate values, you can evaluate a belief, or a distorted opinion, or an opinion which is ultimately some level of distortion. You can evaluate it by its consequences, by the consequences of usage. Meaning, by their fruit shall ye know them. Or, when I was younger, I had more suffering and I had particular beliefs. Now I'm older, I have less suffering, and I find I have different beliefs. Well, that that change or transformation of belief is associated with the improvement of, you know, well-being or life conditions. And now it's certainly possible that awakened people find themselves in dire straits, and people with lesser development have an extended vacation. These are, you know, karmic matters. But in many ways, by the fruit or consequences of particular beliefs or opinions, which is, you know, the distortions, the daily distortion since birth, meaning what does my father, my mother, my brothers, my teachers, my school, my newspaper, my friends, my spouse, my children, my whatever, what do they believe? Well, one can, and how distorted is their belief? One way to look is to consider the consequences or the quality of their life and how well they are. But how well they are is not necessarily the same as how well they say they are or how well they think they are, but how well we may know them to be or they truly are, independent of what they say and what they think, because people don't always speak truthfully and don't always think truthfully or, you know, remain honest with themselves. So, in some sense, then, when we're talking about how does someone discern what's real from what's distorted, everything, excuse me, you can say that all in the octave is a distortion, yet its true nature is infinite reality. Okay? Then, because it's not really right to remain, you know, the terminal conclusion being everything's a distortion. That's not so. Everything is the one infinite creator. But to the extent that we don't know it and live it, to the extent that we don't live it, we don't know it. Right? Anybody can say, oh, everything's one infinite creator, look around, see the creator, okay, I see the creator, cool. Anybody can say it. Anybody can think it. Saying it and thinking it is not knowing it, and surely not living it. So to truly live it, you have to truly know it. And that's relatively independent of what you say or think. There's a lot of stuff that we know and live that we don't even know, or we can't even conceive that we're knowing, like infinity, right? We're living in a dream, but most people think it's quite substantial, real. So they don't talk about that, they don't know about that, they don't think about that, but they are there, like karma. Whether you talk about it, or whether you say it, or whether you know it and think it, it's operative. There are rules. There's physical, metaphysical law, whether or not you know it. Likewise, the nature of apparent finity as an illusion, whose true nature is infinity, that's also not known, but true regardless. And so, to say that everything's distorted is not quite useful, or at least it's not a terminal point. To say that nothing's distorted is also, you know, an exclusionary perspective, right? It's all distorted. It's all God. Yeah, but there's less and more, or there is an apparent spectrum, and there is a difference in consequence between virtue and vice, and lesser and greater development of consciousness. So the real matter is how to discern, and that really, again, comes from love of love and love of truth, and that's very doable as well. Yeah, and that brings up a whole nother matter, which is moving towards making peace with others' distortions that cause them suffering. Moving towards deeper knowing, peacemaking with the deformations of human civilization and the injustice, suffering, oppression, self-sabotage, self-harming, and pain of Earth humanity. And that's not an easy piece of work. That's really bringing light to the darkness, or seeing Godhead in the depths of the distortions that infect these peoples. Seeing Godhead in, or the Absolute, seeing the Absolute Love Light nature, or Absolute nature of the Infinite Creator, which is associated with these qualities of higher self that Ra talked about, complete and whole and perfect. Seeing that the depths of the distortions that infect these peoples by their own doing, and they suffer mightily thereby, which is grievous for anyone who's feeling, me too, is complete and whole and perfect. So one can know that, but it's usually not appropriate to say it, and thinking it is not deeply knowing it. Just because we think it doesn't mean we know it. How do we know we know? Our teacher says so. Somebody beyond me. How do you know you know? I'll leave it up to somebody more evolved than me to confirm and affirm, and I can't. So, only the hairdresser knows, or only Satguru knows. And we don't really know we know. We may think we know, and we may have some greater knowing now apparently than we did before, that has greater consequences or positive consequences now than before. But to say I know, I think is hubris. Only somebody beyond me can confirm that, I would say. But humanity causes itself great pain and suffering by its unrecognized distortions, which, from the perspective of non-duality, or Law of One, or reality, beyond distortion, is complete and whole and perfect, in some sense. It's quite painful at the emotional level, and doesn't make sense intellectually, and seems wrong, or the Creator screwed up from a spiritual level. So there's, right, physical, emotional, mental, spiritual. Emotionally, it's painful to behold, and we participate and are grieved and affected painfully by it, being here. Intellectually, it doesn't quite make sense. We can't understand, how can this be? How can this be perfect? Or how can this be, and how has it come to be? Why does it persist? And spiritually, it seems, in somehow, God is angry, you know, God is an evil tyrant. What some Gnostics think, God the Demiurge, what some Satanists think, right? They hate God, or they think that they have father complex or mother complex, generally. So they hate a personified supreme spiritual authority, parentified in their mind, God the Father, God the Father Mother, Mother Mary, or, you know, our Father in Heaven, like we're children. There's some truth to that view of Source as parent, and us come from Source as children, or offspring, or heirs to the parents, the Source. But that's also limited. That's also a distortion view. All views are distortion. The whole five skanda set is a distortion. But to make peace with that at all levels, including the spiritual, metaphysical, is a great piece of work. But coming to peace with it doesn't mean, oh, I like it. It just means, I think I know it, and I think I understand it, and although I'm in pain and they're in pain, I accept it as some kind of metaphysical justice. There is some metaphysical justice still, despite all the pain and apparent injustice, or human-level injustice. So thank you for such a good question to begin this series on the philosophy of spiritual concepts, or a deeper a deeper examination, a deeper look into the meaning of these common words, concepts we use to talk about spiritual path and development. So thanks for that. Please take good care of yourselves, and good night.